Good evening. Oh my goodness. So many friendly faces this evening. Okay. Welcome friends and family near and far. Welcome for all of our folks who are here and all of our folks who are going to watch us remotely on Zoom. We are here to honor the life of Benjamin Julius McFall. This will be our humble attempt to capture a life well lived. What we have found out in the past 2 months since his passing is that he has touched thousands. Every day for his 70 plus years, he touched the hearts of many. And today we will honor his life and hopefully bring a little bit of that forward. So I have a few thank yous before we start. We have some slideshows, so some of the pieces will be pre-recorded, some of our speakers will be live. We will have indeed some slideshows, courtesy of John Vivian and Rob. I want to thank our outstanding events crew, Sabir and Tico, for which none of this would happen, and Kevin, who's playing tech behind the scenes. Andrea, where are you? Ben's fabulous webpage is courtesy of Andrea, who did all that work in her spare time. Thank you for bringing his heart and soul to life for us. For Billy and Constance, Constance couldn't be here today, but they have been the heart and soul of bringing this program to life. So it is with great gratitude that we've spent many Tuesdays on the phone putting this all together. An enormous thank you to Ben's nieces, Michelle and Renee, and to Jim, Ben's partner. We are proud to do this together. This one is full of love. And a big thank you to Nancy Bass-Wyden for allowing us to use your home and your space. We couldn't think of a better place for Ben. Okay, we will get started. We're going to walk through the seasons of Ben's life. So what we tried to do when we put the program together was bring you through some of his childhood, some of his family, some of his friends, some of the Strand cast, and some interesting folks in between. To know Ben is to love Ben. And what we have found was the common thread in the hundreds of cards we found down at his memorial, on the hundreds of pictures that were submitted online. Every day he taught us something. And if you paid a little attention, there were lessons in every word that left his mouth. So I will start with Ben's nieces. Michelle and Renee, would you mind joining us?
Good evening. I'm Renee Gilliard Griffin. I'm Benny's oldest niece. Our mother, Patsy, was his sister, technically his half-sister, but we never put much store on those kind of distinctions because family is family, whether biologically or by choice. As I am sure will come as no surprise to you, Benny was a great uncle. Michelle and I spent most of our childhood growing up in Ohio, but every year our summer vacation was a road trip to Detroit to visit our grandparents. And when I was young, knowing that we might see Benny, that would be the highlight of the trip, because Benny was fun. He would play with us. He didn't just tolerate us as little people, but he would really play with us. And he had a way of making me feel like I was special, like he really and truly saw me. He had this amazing trunk of comic books. It was amazing, and I coveted it with a deep passionate longing. And as soon as I could slip away from the adults, I would go up in the closet and pull that trunk down and spend hours sitting on the floor and reading Katie Keene, Richie Rich, and of course, Superman. He must have had every Superman and Justice League comic book up to a point. And I mean this sincerely, from like number one to wherever it stopped. And I think that's why my first crush was on Aquaman. I remember sitting next to Benny on the piano and asking him to play Debussy's Cakewalk for me. I was taking piano lessons at the time, and I played from that red John Hopkins book, Primer. And so I got inspiration looking at my uncle, listening to my uncle play the piano so beautifully. And it wasn't a short piece. And I would have the audacity to ask him to play it over and over again. And he always indulged me. He did roll his eyes at me one time, but he did indulge me. I remember as I got a little older, I asked my mother why we didn't see Benny anymore when we visited Detroit. She told me that he had moved to Connecticut to work with books. And I thought, books? Cool. After all, that's what grown-ups do. They grow up and they move away to work. Because I wasn't ready to understand that Benny had moved away so he could really be Benny. The memory of my uncle that I treasure the most was him telling me at my sister's wedding, after meeting my young adult children for the first time, how amazing they were. And it wasn't a simple platitude. He really meant it. And I knew that if Benny thought they were amazing, we had done something right.
Good evening, and thank you all for coming. I'm Michelle Gilliard Sheehan. One of the things I've realized with Benny's passing is how much he was not just our uncle, but how over the course of his life, he became a best friend, a confidant, and a brother to so many people. It has been overwhelming to read his Facebook page. The first few weeks after his passing, I read and reread each post and the comments of each post. And then, as the Strand invited people to write their remembrances of him on a postcard, and added them to that beautiful web memorial web page, I've read all of those too. In the comments and the tributes, we see his outside capacity to love his fellow human being. The beauty he saw in his surroundings, frequently captured through his photographs of flowers, and the passion for the arts, and with that, the human spirit, which was expressed through his poetry, a lifelong little affair of choral music, and his devotion to the Strand, the one place where he knew he could simply be free to be. He called this his home. He referred to the young staff who passed through and sometimes stayed as his children. While Benny certainly had his dramatic flair, his biting wit, and was one of the most charming, engaging, and reverent beings I have ever met, it was his way to disarm you as he spoke the truth. Benny was a teenager when I was born, and by the time I was old enough to engage him in some level of conversation, perhaps when I was six or so, whenever we were together, he felt like an older brother rather than an uncle. His playful spirit was always on display, and I tell you, as my sister said, he spoke to us as equals. We walked, we talked, and we laughed, and made up age-appropriate cheeky rhymes, which are seared into our brains to this very day and make us giggle. Benny was a savant of literature, of arts, and of life, and he knew it. But what I really enjoyed was simply being in his presence. There was something about the energy that he gave off that just made you want to be near. He didn't have to make one of his bracing comments. He didn't have to flash that 10,000 watt smile or those show those marvelous teeth. And he didn't have to let out one of those delicious full-throated laughs. It was in his quiet presence and the abiding familial connection that we shared that I will miss the most. It was simply the chance to be with Uncle Benny.
Thank you, ladies. Ben has touched so many lives and so many Strand lives. Jan, would you join us? Reading Ben's poem, I Wish, Dan Dechabert.
I loved Ben. I still love him. I probably always will. And it's comforting to be around so many other people that loved him too. I feel better, and thank you for that. I Wish, by Benjamin McFall. I wish I were climbing trees this morning. I would climb a golden maple on Myrtle Avenue. Among the leaves, my melanin against them would prove me a gem chameleon, hiding inadvertently my limbs upon branches. Breathing topaz and zircon, pinned for design and movement in space. Becoming facets of amber light that turn on themselves in the sun, in the air.
Thank you, Jan. Okay, technology folks, are we ready? So for those of you who don't know, Ben was also a singer. 26 years in the New York City Gay Men's Chorus. So we have a special treat for you today. The chorus has given us their gift of a recording. Prepare yourself for a ton of photos. And if you listen closely, you might hear Benny.
Sunset, blue for the ocean, yellow to grow things green. Then God made lavender for things in between. but somehow bold. When God made lavender, I swear he broke the mold. To some it isn't primary, to me it seems profound. People misuse it, why did you choose it? Why does the earth go primary? To me, it seems profound. People misuse it. Why did you choose it? Why does the earth go round? And foolish, moody at moments, hardly a neutral hue. God must have made me lavender, so
gosh, no matter how many times we see that one, it's still a three-tissue song. Okay. You ready, Bill? Okay. Next up is longtime friend and colleague, Russian-speaking colleague, who will speak as the poets have mournfully sung, Bill McGee.
As the poets have mournfully sung, death takes the innocent young, the rolling in money, the screamingly funny, and those who are very well hung. Love you, Ben.
God, that was so perfect for you. I was wondering. Should have known. Always a little levity, a lot of laughs, and a lot of love. Okay. I don't know where we go after that, Bill. Okay. A late entry, not on your programs, came in late last night, as a matter of fact. John Westie, a lifelong friend of Ben's since their freshman year in college, came through with some last minute thoughts. You ready, gang? Okay. John Westie.
But one last story that you might appreciate is this one. Benny had made a lot of friends in the world by 1973, and one of his friendships took him again to Montreal. He was attending a conference with his friend Roy about subliminal advertising. I think he was taking a bus to go back to New York from Montreal and would have made it, but for the indiscreet placement of windowpane LSD in his jacket pocket. That earned him a couple nights in the Franklin County Jail. He was allowed one phone call, and he called me. He said, "Oh, Johnny, I think this will be all right. I'm going to see the judge tomorrow, and I'll probably get out then. You shouldn't have to bail me out or anything. Please call my mother and let her know that everything is all right." So, dutifully, I called Joetta and told her exactly as I was instructed, that everything was going to be all right. When we hung up the phone, I felt confident that we were dealing with a situation. 2 hours later, Joetta called me back and said, "John, I've been thinking about this, and if there is a way that you could go to the jail and bail him out tonight, I would sleep better." So I borrowed my girlfriend's car, drove to St. Albans, got my checkbook out, and wrote a check for his bail. Benny didn't realize I was coming for him and was quite angry that I did. He kept saying that I ruined his chances to write great literature by depriving him of the essential experience of being in the Franklin County Jail. I simply said, "Benny, you've been outranked this time." Thanks for everyone who appreciates Benny. Thanks for celebrating this fine man, and may love continue in our hearts for this guy.
Again, where do we go from there? Okay, late ad. Who knows what you're gonna get in the middle of the night, Billy? Okay. We will stay with the pre-recorded portion. Fellows, are you ready? We have Victor Grossetti, who is Ben's longtime friend and fellow choir member from the Pan Am Choir.
Thank you. I offer my condolences to Ben's partner, Jim Burley, to his family, particularly his nieces, Renee and Michelle, and to his beloved colleagues at the Strand, his chosen family, in particular to Billy Mowbray, whose efforts have brought us all together tonight to celebrate the life of Ben McFall. I can still remember his laugh, the joy he brought to the most absurd situations, a happiness that emanated from him like Keith Haring's radiant baby. Ben McFall and I arrived in New York City in 1978, a magical year, him to work at the Strand Bookstore and me to move in with my true love, the late Paige Jackson, my partner for 40 years. We met Ben in 1981, when he joined the New York City Gay Men's Chorus. Paige was a founding member of the chorus, and he and Ben bonded immediately over their shared love of books and music. Those weren't the only things that cemented our friendship with Ben. There was his intelligence, his wit, his compassion, his joie de vivre, his commitment to representation as a gay Black man in America, and his sweet soul. We were all so young, so happy, so gay, that I can't properly convey what a wonderful world full of possibilities lay before us back then. Ben loved to be where the action was, and between the friends he made in New York, the excitement of singing fabulous music at Carnegie Hall with the NYC GMC and some of the great performers of our age, guest stars, and traveling the world with the Pan Am Chorus Angelorum for almost a decade, he got his wish. Whether getting on a chartered bus to travel upstate to sing a Christmas AIDS benefit concert with the Gay Men's Chorus, or boarding business class on a Pan Am jumbo jet and flying down to Rio to sing at Corcovado with the Chorus Angelorum, being with Ben added that frisson of elegance and class and bonhomie, which never deserted him. He was always beautifully attired, perfectly composed, and ready with a smile. Even when the rest of us were freaking out about something, Ben was our rock of Gibraltar, even-keeled, good-humored, calm, and kind. Long before Instagram and digital cameras, Ben was an accomplished photographer who took exceptional photos, which he often printed and tinted and presented to his friends. I recall the stunning series of photographs he took in San Gimignano, Italy. No, they weren't of the famous towers in that sleepy little town. They were of our handsome friend, Stephen Server, framed by the ancient Gothic window of their hotel, taking a shower, captured by Ben. Through Ben's eyes, his simple daily ablution was elevated to art. Ben was one of the best travelers I've ever known because he was prepared for everything. He was up for anything and he was completely unflappable. I never saw Ben truly angry or upset. I'm Italian, so this was something new to me. But Ben was always tranquil, serene, funny, wise, and wonderful. Traveling in Italy with Ben was a delight. The wine, I was drinking back then, the men, the music, the food, the sights, it was living a dream, and we knew it, because we were also living through another grossly mishandled health crisis, the AIDS pandemic. Ben lost his partner, Timmy Pollock, to AIDS back in 1985. Ben was heroic in his grief, and he taught us all how to handle such a catastrophe. He carried on with his life and continued working at his beloved Strand, where he gained so many friends among the staff and the customers who adored him, and singing with his chorus families. But the losses continued. So many of Ben's dearest friends were taken far too young, and the Gay Men's Chorus was singing at a memorial service every month. We suffered unimaginable losses during those scary times, but they were offset to some degree as we held each other closer and loved each other more. Ben's great big heart provided a balm to all of us dealing with grief and loss. And we were blessed too. We got to fly to Rome every spring with the Pan Am Chorus, to visit Sorrento when the lemon groves were in bloom, and to Venice, La Serenissima, a place both Ben and Paige adored. Ben particularly loved shopping for the black glass beads in Venice, which he wore for many years. I remember going out very late one night in Venice with Ben, who had a new camera and wanted to try some special film to capture the magic of the moonlight on the water and the monuments of the city. It was beautifully still that night with just the sound of the water lapping against the gondolas and the moonlight glimmering on the canals. And that's how I'll always remember my friend Ben McFall, doing something that he loved in a place he loved, treating life like an adventure and everyone like a friend, opening our eyes to the beauty and wonder all around us while remaining delightfully charming, erudite, funny, and serene. We may not have known it, but he was indeed our very own Serenissima, the most serene one. Thank you, Ben.
Thank you, Ben. Okay, next up, Mr. Paul Secor, longtime Strand employee, manager, buyer, and friend. When Paul signed on for this gig, I don't know that he ever thought he would be the one going through Ben's belongings. So those ties that you see in the back are courtesy of what Paul and Billy have found in Ben's belongings. Please take one before you go, and I'll leave the rest to you, Paul, please.
Hello, I want to thank you all for coming tonight to celebrate this extraordinary man. Ben's death at the end of last year was indeed a great loss, but being able to talk about him is a great joy. As I sat at lunch the next day, I thought, you don't have an intimate relationship with the sun, but you build your life on the expectation that it will always be there. I have known Ben for all 43 years of his career at the Strand. That is longer than I've known anyone who isn't a family member. I have been in New York for 3 years when I met him, but I was still, in many ways, the young man from upstate. Neither one of us imagined the long future we would share. Each of us, in our own way, found a new home here, a place that fit us perfectly, quirks and all. Ben was the only person left who knew that me We trace a good deal of our history through the people we know. It feels like my history has suddenly been shortened in a very unsettling way. A major piece of my history, my life, went with him. There is a hole where there used to be a connection. In many ways, we weren't close friends, but 43 years of shared history in the store and as gay residents of this weird and overwhelming and marvelous city in transformative times created a bond that I had with no one else. It was an age of revolution and evolution. We overthrew who we were and, in time, became who we are now. Our experiences in those times of gay abandon and gay tragedy were very different. Ben lost his beloved Tim, while I remain relatively unscathed. But we shared a complex context that can't be conveyed to someone who wasn't there. 43 years of checking in, checking progress, checking reality. 43 years of turning to the sun to feel its glow on my face. As we aged and increasingly found friends among those who weren't born when we started here, those bedrock memories became more distant, but no less important, the bond more apparent. Ben was always the same, witty, elegant, except when he chose not to be, frank and charming. The last two don't often go together. He showed us that being gay was as natural a part of who we are as the color of our eyes, and just as open to comment or compliment. He lived his entire life and his worsening health with a humor and grace that I have rarely seen. The love that flowed to him every day from fellow employees and customers was wondrous. He inspired, he encouraged, he mentored, he taught, correcting gently but firmly. There was also iron. He impressed everyone, but never traded on it. He knew who he was, he knew his own worth, and was satisfied with it. He did not need to demonstrate it to anyone. He was always, in every setting and encounter, just Ben. It was enough. There was never a need to be more.
Thank you, Paul. Okay, next up, Darius, will you join us? I didn't mean to startle you. Darius was employed at the Strand in the summer of 1985 for exactly 1 month. 5 years later, Darius James has his first book, Negrophobia, on our shelves. It is an honor and a privilege to have you here, sir. He is going to read Ben McFall's I Entered Into the Air.
Thank you. I became friends with Ben much later than 1985, but that's another story, not for here. I entered into the air. I enter into air with it already fine black filaments, soft about baby's eyes, covering my head. And within 14 years, loath to comb it, cut in back like lawn on putting greens, bristles about the egg. Day two of high school, an old nectarine demanded they that remove it, yet fuzz for my lips, my cheeks, and my eyes became the focus of my head, framed by it, and lids on brows, growing coarse, regrowing from flesh by day and ingrowing. Year 19 in late January, care for the natural, allied with siblings against barbers and haberdashers, begin to let it grow. And from every follicle on head and body, it grew, safe from sounds of snipping scissors, buzzing clippers, scraping razors, and so too from their sting. But year 22, it began to leave its roots at the casual bequest of heredity, leaving at the whim of a comb, a cleansing shampoo, the slightest of breezes, leaving despite my cries that it remain and live. More mobile than when bound to movement of my legs, I find it woven into the weave of towels, of blankets. I find it on the shoulders of kissing friends, in drinks, in my food, tight black curls aloft, and random currents of space, protein calling guards.
Thank you, Darius. Stephen, you ready? Over Ben's life, he touched the lives of many customers. Stephen, you often see at the used buying desk. Stephen is a longtime friend and Strand customer.
So 20 years ago, I had to get some money to buy some drugs. And somebody said, you can sell books to the Strand. So I did. There was this man in the back by the fiction section. I didn't know it was the fiction section. It was dark back there, but he was a black man. And I asked him for a couple of dollars. And he said, I don't know you. And he became my therapist. And I was going to the Strand 6 times a week. Every week for 20 years after that, selling books. I got off drugs, but he remained my therapist. He would talk about middle-class black life and make me feel, wow, that's like a great thing to be normal. And I became normal. And he never looked down or up or sideways to me. He was just Ben. And I miss him. And I miss him calling me Little Stevie Moore. And I never asked him why he put the little in front of there, but but, you know, it was just a thing. In fact, he never called me Steven or Mr. Moore. It was a complete thing, Little Stevie Moore. And yeah, that's about it.
Okay, you never know what twists and turns this one's going to take. Okay. For those who know the Strand, you also know that we are a tight family. And one of the many things I've seen in my 2 years with the Strand is that we take care of each other. Amanda, are you ready? Amanda is a dear friend, a force for good, and one of the crew that took care of Ben in the mornings when he became ill. There are a handful of us who were on his breakfast routine. So, you know, as the chief operating officer, one day I got a text from Ben giving me his breakfast order. Okay, I said, did you mean for this for me? Yes. I would like one hard boiled egg, salt and pepper, please, on the side. I would like an English muffin, not wrapped in foil, because that makes it soggy. Yogurt, preferably banana, one banana, and a green Gatorade, not blue, not red, green. So occasionally we found out after many months that he had placed this breakfast order with many of us. Amanda was one of the crew on many mornings that he received multiple breakfast orders, and Amanda and Abby made sure that every day when his Uber brought him to 828 that he would get to his office safely. So thank you for being a helper and a good friend. Without further ado, Amanda Wolfe.
Have to be prepared. Water's ready, tissue's ready. Ben had the amazing ability to be both a parent and a friend, an elder and an equal, a guide and a comrade. When I started working at the Strand, my mother had passed away only months before. I was still in so much pain and felt raw, but Ben was always a safe haven, a compassionate ear, and a strong shoulder to cry on. When I felt alone in my grief, he was there to comfort me and assure me I was not alone. He understood. He got it. We'd swap stories and memories of our mothers and what it was like to lose them. We talked about how they would feel about us now, which movies they liked and watched with us. Ben showed me it was possible to get through that pain and to thrive. He commiserated and shared with me when we had known each other for not even a month. 3 years later, in 2016, I was 30 years old and finally coming to terms with being gay. Ben was one of my, what I like to call, gayrents. A gay parental figure who is there to support you, answer your questions, and guide you into gaydom. He was great with book recommendations from Ruby Fruit Jungle, Oranges Are Not the Only Fruit, and The Best Little Boy in the World are just the core of the titles that he recommended. And whenever he was buying in books and came across some interesting new title, lesbian title, he'd tell me about it, whether it was a biography of the woman who wrote Harriet the Spy, I had no clue she was gay, to a title about the lesbian couple sitting in the Christopher Park statue in front of Stonewall Inn. The book was called The Audacity of a Kiss. He also put up very well with my constant exclamations of, I'm gay! every day for like 3 years, that's all I said. As you can tell, coming out was monumental to me, a huge deal. The younger generation was not surprised or as impressed as I thought the moment warranted. But Ben was there to empathize with me and did not even tease me too hard when I realized I was complaining about young ones not understanding to a gay man who had survived the AIDS crisis. In 2019, I discovered my transmasculine identity. Ben was there to tell me to only buy 100% silk ties and to show me how to tie them. He gave me sweater vests, told me where to get this suit tailored around the corner. He gave the deciding vote in the all-important question of which men's shoe to wear. It's a Chuck boot. But Ben was encouraging no matter what my identity. When I thought I was straight, he was enthused about how good I looked in dresses. He was particularly fond of the photos he captured of me arrayed in florals for Miguel and Richard's wedding. I was the bubble girl instead of the flower girl. I made sure to get my accessories approved by him, no matter which identity I had. He was accepting of them. And no matter which stage of acceptance of life in which I found myself, I always knew Ben was someone I could go to. He was always a safe port amongst the chaos, and I knew I'd eventually end up smiling if I had a talk with Ben. I missed out on being on an equal footing with my mom, yet still getting advice and guidance. never told my mom I was gay. But Ben gave me the greatest gift of not only his friendship and camaraderie, but the chance to have that true parental relationship and approval. Our relationship has meant the world to me. I will be forever grateful. Thank you, Ben. I love you.
And that is part of Ben's legacy. Tom, are you ready, sir? Okay. Next up, we have our Tom McDonald, friend and colleague, who will read one of Ben's poems, "For the Men Who Have Cried on My Shoulder."
For the Men Who Have Cried on My Shoulder, by Benjamin McFall. Thank you for your fears and for making me afraid enough to build momentary structures to stand against them. Thank you for pointing out the shelter in my arms. Thank you for providing the moments for us to fail to wave our deeds like banners that hide the location of our battlefields, for your tears that mirror common ground. Thank you for letting me discover at the nape of your neck the finest hair of your scalp, to find that here we are unabashedly soft as women. Thank you for letting me be the father none of us has, for time enough to see the one I have in myself, hear his voice soft, gentle as my mother's, within and without my mouth. Thank you, Benjamin. You are high art.
Thank you, Tom. Ben was many things. He was a writer and an oracle and spent much time in the literary field. Lise Lucas is a friend of Ben's and the publisher of Pantheon and Shockton Books.
Already been crying quite a lot. I'm so sorry. So I didn't write anything because I didn't know what to write. I can't remember when I met Ben. I have no idea when it was. I couldn't tell you the first time I saw him. It was surely here in this store. I started coming here maybe 1 to 7 times a week, roughly in 2001, after I graduated college. And I was always a really chatty person. And I would come in and I'd look for whatever I was looking for, and I had questions. What's the best biography of World War II? What's the most exciting book about blah, 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 blah? What novel should I read? And because Ben was always sitting in his area and he was always so charming and I was always so attracted to his spirit, we started talking. I can't tell you what it was about, but I'm sure he was recommending me books. And so that time, maybe 20 years ago, when I met him, that was the beginning of a relationship. And somehow, when Ben passed away last year, I was absolutely dumbstruck because I hadn't realized that he'd become one of my favorite people in the whole wide world. And that I had been coming into this store and looking for him every week for years and decades. And we talked about my father dying, and we talked about my jobs, and we talked about Black family, and we talked about how lonely it is to be a Black person in books, whether it's a bookshop or a magazine or a publisher or a nonprofit organization. We laughed our asses off. I remember walking in one day, and I was minding my own business. I wasn't even looking for him that day. And I just see somebody run through the front room and say, "There's a fly in here, and it's got to die." I'd walk in and I'd either be dressed like I'd had a rough night the night before, and he'd say, "What were you doing?" Or I'd be dressed for work and he'd say, oh, you look sharp today. Fancy, huh? And I'd walk in and I'd have a look on my face and he'd know I was really sad or really happy. And he saw me go from a girl that was working at a nonprofit theater company that did stuff for young people to a film company, but I was always book obsessive. And then at a certain point, I started working at Guernica in the Brooklyn Book Festival. And I remember even back then, he was so proud of me. He was like, oh, this is great. And we would talk about work and gossip about how work works. And then I got the job at the foundation. And that was sort of, I think for someone like Ben, probably really satisfying to see. One of our big national notable literary nonprofits was actually led by a woman of color. And he understood what it was like to be the only one or one of very few. And he would check on me. He'd send me flowers, pictures of flowers, to be clear. Pictures of corners of his eyeball or chin. He'd call me to ask how in the world, and I decided not to drop that F-bomb. How in the world do you pronounce Ta-Nehisi Coates? He would just send little notes, but he would always say, I'm so, so proud of you. And he would sit there and he'd be pricing books at his desk. And I was always so annoyed when there was a line because we were all his most special person. And I'd wait, lurking around. Sometimes I'd interrupt the conversation that he was having and then I'd make a new friend. And there's so many people that waited in the Ben line that have become people that I talk to on social media or talk to in the store or know just in general. But most of all, I think about Ben treating me like family. We could talk about whatever was going on, and we met in this very strange context in a store, and we all New Yorkers have this experience where you become friends with the person in your bodega or at your tailor or, you know, at the coffee shop. But it's an even rarer experience when that person becomes one of the people of your life. I think a lot about work because that's the journey that I'm on. And I watched Ben sit comfortably being exactly the person that he is and was in that seat, shouting when he felt like it, hooting and hollering when he felt like it, scolding lovingly when he needed to, telling jokes, making sure it was fun, caring about the people that he worked with, bitching about the people that he worked with. You know, and I then and now always wanted to be like him. We do totally different jobs, but the spirit with which he lived his life, completely authentic, completely loving, completely kind, completely unmoored from any sense of decorum that we would expect from someone. He just lived and laughed. I'm not gonna say loved, don't you dare. I'll miss his big smile and his beautiful hugs and the fact that there was a person here in this building that I could walk in unannounced on any Saturday or any Tuesday or any day, and there would be love. And I think I've always thought about books and love together, and I think about Ben and books together, and I think it's a really beautiful circle to think about how those things all come together in him. My life is so much better for having known him. And it's one of the most peculiar and the most enriching friendships I've ever had. Jim, my love, everybody at the Strand, my love. You know, I think our job now is to just carry on in his honor with a little grace and a little humor and a little cussing and absolutely a little style and flair. So I love you, Ben. I miss you so much. I haven't been here since he passed. So it's hard to be back, but it feels like he's here. And that makes me really happy. Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa. That was beautiful. Okay. Part of Ben's draw was his draw to literary figures as well. We are honored to have Marlon James, novelist and a friend of Ben's, who decided to say a few words.
Hello, Strand. It's a gloomy afternoon in London, and I guess it's in some ways maybe appropriate for, I was going to say a gloomy occasion, but that seems so counter to the person that we're talking about. We don't talk about gloom when we talk about Ben. We don't talk about sadness when we talk about Ben, because Ben was just such a force of light and laughter. He's the only person I know who can make a quiet laughter boom. And he was, I said this when I heard of him joining the ancestors, that if you're a writer, you may not know it, that Ben was your best friend. And such a lover and celebrator of books and celebrator of writers. I remember meeting him and him, you know, was like so happy to meet me. I'm like, I'm in the presence of, this is an icon. And if, you know, like, if you're somebody like me who've been coming to the Strands from before I even realized I could write, then I've known of Ben from before I even knew I was a writer. And I knew he was a champion of books and a lover of books and just one of those people who, before he even moved to Summerlin, New York, he defines a certain kind of New York for you. And I hope with his passing, an era doesn't go, because I think that would be very anti-Ben. I think that would disappoint him, I think, if a certain era ends when he's not with us. That's not what he did. That's not the seeds he sowed in at the Strand. And that's not why, you know, we still go and we still consider it one of the few remaining real havens in New York. But I just want to, you know, join in celebrating Ben's remarkable and wonderful life, his light, his fantastic spirit, his generous personality and demeanor, and those beautiful eyes always peering over those thick glasses. Because you know behind those eyes was something that you really were waiting for him to tell you. And it would have been something about the next greatest book you will ever read. We love you and we miss you, but it goes without saying that as soon as we enter the Strand, you will be there.
Next, we have Anthony Yearwood, a longtime friend of Ben's, who would like to say a few words and pay tribute. Please join us, Anthony.
It is a privilege to be here this evening to say a few words about a beloved friend. I first started coming down to the Strand in the early 1960s when I was in high school. The Strand and New York City were very different places then. The 60s morphed into the 70s, and I continued to frequent the store. To the best of my recollection, there were no African American staff at the time. If they were here, they were hiding, and I didn't see them. Fast forward to 1978, on a routine visit, I walked into the store, and there, in the back, in the fiction section, in living color, was Ben McFall. I was so delighted and excited at seeing him that I walked right up to him and said, "You are an idea whose time has come." That was with a nod to the ending of the movie classic Casablanca, the beginning of a beautiful friendship. Several years ago, Benny reminded me that I had said that to him. I had long forgotten. As the years went by and he matured, it was marvelous to see him become an institution within an institution. I think of all the interesting people he introduced me to over the years when I was here on one of my many visits to the store. I marveled at his encyclopedic knowledge of fiction, which was his bailiwick, but of the other subject areas as well, as he fielded countless queries from Strand customers. It was wonderful to see Benny mentor generations of young staff here and to see how they looked up to him and to see him interact joyfully with his colleagues, one of whom, and I can't remember his name, but he once described Benny as a retired Negro actress. He was also known as Mother Fiction. He was tickled by these hilarious monikers, and we had lots of laughs about them. Benny was a very good friend, kind, considerate, and generous. He was always playful, but never played games with you. He was honest and direct, and not to be trifled with. And being a very good and loyal friend, he was never shy about scolding me, albeit gently, when he felt that I was being foolish and doing something that was not in my best interest. I valued his opinions greatly and was impressed with how perceptive he was and what insight he demonstrated with regard to a variety of people, things, and situations. I admired how exceptionally artistic and talented he was. Throughout the years, our friendship deepened. There were lots and lots of good times, but there was also sorrow in both our lives. We comforted one another. I miss my friend. I loved him dearly. And I'm so grateful for our friendship, for being in each other's lives for so long. The void that Benny's passing has created cannot be easily filled, if at all. He was that unique a person, an extraordinary individual. Some people are irreplaceable. As time goes on, and I think of Benny, which I know I will do quite often, there's so much to remind me of the times we were together, the things we did together, and the confidences we shared. If I'm sad that he's not physically here anymore, and even angry that he was taken from us too soon, I know that I will begin to smile and laugh when I remember all the great fun and good times we had together, all the numerous phone calls and emails. I think I count something like 400 emails over a period of 15 years, many of which have his wonderful photographs of flowers. Emails back and forth over the years. I will cherish those wonderful memories and find solace in them. May the memory of Benjamin Julius McFall be eternal, in the hearts and minds of all those who knew him and admired him, and all those who loved him. Thank you.
Thank you, Anthony. Okay, I am here to set the record straight on something. For many of you who have known Ben, it is so aptly noted that we were all his best friends. So when he spoke to you, there was truly no one else in the universe. And despite other folks jockeying for position, it is today that I declare Billy Mowbray Benjamin McFall's best friend. Billy, are you ready, sir? Reading When I Hear at the Close of the Day by Walt Whitman, Benjamin McFall's best friend, Billy Mowbray.
Page 26 from the book The Faggots and Their Friends Between Revolutions by Larry Mitchell reads, Women Wisdom. The rule is, you get more warm fuzzies by giving away all your own warm fuzzies. Keeping your warm fuzzies to yourself results in a large accumulation of cold prickles. Ben McFall gave away all his warm fuzzies and loved everyone. But let me tell you about the people he hated. Just kidding. You can private message me later for the full list. Some people called him Benjamin, Benny, the Oracle, Benitha, or Nitha. But I usually just called him Ben. He called me Wheezy or Wheeze because I'm from Louisiana, or sometimes Billy Willie, like my granny did. For a time, I worked in the classic section and price sheet music right next to him for almost 40 hours a week. It was the most glorious time, though occasionally we'd have to be forcibly separated like toddlers. Thanks, Liz. We bonded over music, specifically over various artists' interpretations of the Great American Songbook. He'd correct my pitch when I sang, but I claimed I was just experimenting with interpretation. We reveled in the delight of ultrasonic foot therapy from our podiatrist. We ate weenies at Barclays before Barbara and saw Bette at Madison Square Garden. We went to the gay plays and had inside jokes about stories and dreams and secret obsessions. He loved me even when I revealed the things I was most ashamed of. And he praised all of my triumphs, no matter how small. And we fought over the ridiculous and mundane. During a rough period in my life, I would yell at anyone who tried to shelve in my section because I didn't want to lose a single moment with him. I even made someone cry once. Sorry, Tori. I didn't understand that he could love them and me at the same time. Ben gave me the space to be exactly who I was, where I was, and when I was. He made it okay to just be a flawed human being experiencing life in that exact moment. And I know he did that for so many others. We laughed at the deepest pain and the darkest thoughts and the utterly absurd. And we just couldn't stop laughing. In the fall, he made a request and I kept putting it off, subconsciously knowing it was a final wish. But he was persistent. Once the task was completed, he left us exactly 2 weeks later. The day before he passed, I texted him about something I'd done, and I said, "Don't hate me." He replied, as he had so many times before, "Too late for that." See, even if Ben hated you, he still loved you. I'm proof. And since he's passed, I've hated him on more than one occasion and said quite loudly, "You fucker!" Upon confession to a colleague last week, they asked, "And what did Ben say back?" Nothing. He just flashed those pearly whites. And how do you stay mad at that smile? Those good teeth. One of his favorite lyrics, "If you ever lose your teeth when you're out to dine, borrow mine." That's friendship, baby. At one point, he made me buy this thick-ass book with Bible-thin pages and said, "Every homosexual should own the Walt Whitman Library of America." And then he only ever recommended one poem. When I heard at the close of the day how my name had been received with plaudits in the Capitol, still, it was not a happy night for me that followed. And else when I caroused or when my plans were accomplished, still, I was not happy. But the day when I rose at dawn from the bed of perfect health, refreshed, singing, inhaling the ripe breath of autumn, when I saw the full moon in the west grow pale and disappear in the morning light, when I wandered alone over the beach and undressing, bathed, laughing with the cool waters, and saw the sunrise, and when I thought how my dear friend, my lover, was on his way coming, oh, then I was happy. Oh, then each breath tasted sweeter, and all that day my food nourished me more, and the beautiful day passed well, and the next came with equal joy, and with the next at evening came my friend. And that night, while all was still, I heard the waters roll slowly, continually up the shores. I heard the hissing rustle of the liquid and sands as directed to me, whispering to congratulate me. For the one I love most lay sleeping by me under the same cover in the cool night, in the stillness, in the autumn moonbeams. His face was inclined toward me, and his arm lay lightly around my breast. And that night, I was happy. In the name of Ben McFall, I implore each of you to go out from here and give away all your own warm fuzzies. Or don't. Ben wouldn't care. He'd still love you just the way you are.
Thank you, Billy. There were many of our Strand family who couldn't join us today. So in an attempt to gather as much love as humanly possible, Constance and Rob gave us a video tribute.
Ben came to my first show in New York, and I remember thinking how much effort that must have been for him because of his health. So I was just so surprised and thrilled to see him there, but I saw him after the show, and I just remember him giving me a big hug and a kiss on the cheek and telling me how proud he was of me, and I'll always remember that. I just think it's amazing how anything anyone has ever said about Ben is true.
I found out that Ben had been selected to be my Secret Santa, and I truly felt like the luckiest person in that store, as if the actual Santa Claus had been chosen as my personal gift giver. And in true Benny fashion, he gave me a pair of sparkly, and I mean like really covered in glitter, blue leggings. I believe they were children's leggings, a size XL, which made me laugh. And those leggings shed glitter all over the store and continue to shed glitter all over everything in my tights drawer when I brought them home. But I really, really treasured them, and they made me laugh every time I think about them. They're still in a drawer. And I'm gonna miss receiving a beautiful photo from Ben every year, flowers on my birthday, but I will be thinking about you often, and you will be missed by everybody.
Ben wasn't just a great recommender of books because he was so literary. He was also a fantastic reader of people, and not just because we all openly shared far too much with him. Ben made me laugh, and I loved that we could match each other in volume with our laughter. I will miss his advice, often unsolicited and almost always right, especially when it came to fashion. But mostly, Benny was my family, and he made Strand home. Love you, Benny.
I think the problem I'm gonna have is the same problem that everybody's gonna have and has been having for the past few months, which is just, you know, that realization that you're not gonna be able to see him anymore, that, you know, he's not gonna be able to tell you a good word or, you know, tell you something you need to hear. And, you know, it's one less person to be there for you. And Ben was good at being there for you.
From our daily hugs to all the incredible stories, I doubt I'll ever have just the right words to describe what an honor it was to know Ben and call him a friend. I love you forever, Benny. Thank you for the memories.
Most of my memories of Ben McFall are pretty inappropriate, which I think really speaks to his character. So I'll say this. I think it's rare to find someone who is so kind, so attentive and generous, and who will also always encourage my bad behavior. Ben, the Strand will never be the same without you. I love you and I miss you.
Ben McFall was an amazing friend, and I consider myself very lucky to have been able to talk to him nearly every day for 13 years while I worked at the Strand. In my last conversation with Ben, I told him I recently moved to Hamtramck, Michigan, a small city inside the city of Detroit, an area where he spent a lot of his early life. He told me about this banana cream pie down the street from me at this famous bakery, and that's what I did today. I got this banana cream pie in loving memory of Ben McFall.
Ben McFall was a sage. The man always knew exactly what to say to stop your head from spinning like a top about whatever crisis you were fretting about at the time. And because of that, he always felt like this warm lodestar light at the store. And I just tried my absolute best not to take that for granted.
I didn't have grandparents growing up, and from the moment I met Ben, he completely filled that void in a way that I had never thought imaginable. It was so fulfilling to come into Strand and feel that unconditional love coming from him. He took the time to guide us, and especially as a young gay Black woman, it was just being able to have that elder figure in my life did insurmountable good to me. And all I know is that I wish I could have more time with him. I wish I could have more time with him. And I know that wherever he is, it is the best place ever, because he brought light everywhere he went. And I wish I could just be in that light some more.
Me too. Okay, ladies. Again, I bring you Michelle and Renee.
So on behalf of my sister and I, and also our cousins who are watching this evening that he leaves behind, The McFall family wishes to express our sincere thanks to the entire Strand family, past and present, for the love, care, devotion, and support that you provided our uncle, Benjamin Julius McFall III. To have been a young, gay, and out Black man in his 70s could have been a very lonely and difficult existence. But because of Fred Bass and the Strand Bookstore, Benny found a safe haven, a community, and a home that for 43 years he was able to put his imprint on and help to make a place where he and so many others, management, staff, customers alike, always felt welcomed. To the Bass family, Nancy, no words can adequately express how much we appreciate and value what your father, Fred, did for our uncle and for the care and support and devotion that you have personally displayed for Betty. Thank you. My sister and I would like to express our sincere gratitude to everyone who's contributed to this celebration of Benny's life. This includes the friends he has had over the course of his life, from childhood on, fellow booksellers, Strand colleagues and customers, and all the people with whom he sang and also traveled the world. The outpouring of your love and concern means more to us than you'll ever know. A few of you, my sister and I, remember from when we were children, and though bittersweet, it's wonderful to be reconnected. To current Strand employees who helped him during the height of the pandemic when he was still coming to work, and you got him his coffee or helped him get to and from the Ubers as his health declined, thank you. When Benny was no longer able to come to the store, and since his passing, Strand colleagues, again, past and present, have continued to care and support, including helping my sister and I take care of his affairs. For those of you who know Benny's penchant for accumulating things, you probably have a sense of the enormity of this task. There really is no way for us to adequately thank you for all that you have done and continue to do, but please know that we are honored and blessed by your graciousness. In closing, we wish to thank everyone who has given of their personal time these past weeks to make this memorial such a wonderful celebration of his life. We never could have imagined that we would be honoring him in this way. It is truly magnificent, and we are overwhelmed by your loyalty for him. The gift you have given us is a lasting memory of Betty's full and robust zest for life, and we are indebted to your kindness.
So I don't have a lot to add. You will never know the gift you've given us. We will never forget this day. We will never forget it. So I want to echo my sister's comments and simply thank you for being here, for taking the time and thinking it was important to be here, whether you're here with us physically or whether you're with us remotely. Thank you for sharing in this time of celebrating a remarkable human being. I would also like to express my personal appreciation for all of the love and creative energy that went into making this event possible. Your care and your attention speaks volumes about the kind of people you are and the kind of friends you are. Thank you, Team Benny. You know who you are. Laura, Constance, Jim, and of course, Benny, and Billy, excuse me. Know that Benny's love for you and your love for Benny has wrought wonderful magic. It's placed you in our hearts forever and made us family. Thank you.
Josiah, are you ready? Our final Benjamin McFall poem for tonight, 10 Best, read by Josiah Owens.
Ten Best. Ten Best by Benjamin McFall. Attending to the needs of a dying beloved parent, teaching a child to say three instead of tree, visiting the Blue Grotto in a three-man boat, meeting the president, singing from the Carnegie Hall stage with an orchestral accompaniment, receiving applause for something one has written from total strangers, folding bed sheets, finding out one is HIV negative, being alone with great art, experiencing simultaneous orgasm with the favorite lover. There you have it. Hugs and kisses, Ben.
As Benny's nieces so aptly noted, when Ben passed away, he didn't leave us a lot of instructions. We're still looking for this black box, which Paul has not been able to recover yet. His one wish, Billy alluded to earlier, his one wish was a song. And his wish was that Benny sang this, that Billy sang this at his memorial. So I give you So Long Big Time, sung by Billy Mumbry.
Bright lights are dimmer, bankroll is slimmer, looks like I'm down and done, bye-bye. I've got to run, bye-bye. So long, so long, big time. So long, so long, big time. I made it fine, I made it fast. That ain't a sign, it has to last. Had it made for a while in a highfalutin style. So long, so long, big time. Big dough, bright lights, big time. I won't pretend I am glad it's ended. It was fun, now it's done, but I'll never sing a loser's song. So long, big time, I've gotta run so long. Tell the chicks and tell all the cronies, lost it on the cards and the ponies. Tell the friends and fair-weathered phonies, living high. Tell them bye, and tell them why. Lady Luck just gave me the brush off, so I'll rush off and try a new routine. I'm a guy who rolls with the punches and my hunches. It's time to quit the scene. Tell the kids and tell all the cookies. Tell the babes and tell all the book is that I knew that I'm through. And when you do, buy a few beers for me, tell them no tears for me. So long, so long, big time. Big dough, bright lights, big time. Ain't gonna grieve, cause I must be leaving. It was fun, now it's done. But I'll never sing a loser's song. So long, big time, I've gotta run. So
I was relatively new to Team Benny, only being with the Strand almost 2 years. And of the many gifts that Ben gave me, what I'm most grateful for is his unconditional love. What he taught us was to love boldly. What he taught us was to love unconditionally. What he told us was to love all out, all the time, and never ask for forgiveness. I wrote down some of the words tonight because they seem to repeat. Intelligent, light, playful, kind, rare, honest, humorous, generous spirit, direct, loyal, witty, extraordinary, amazing, family, honor, laughter, and love. Oneness by Thich Nhat Hanh. The moment I die, I will try to come back to you as quickly as possible. I promise it will not take long. Isn't it true? I am already with you in every moment. I come back to you in every moment. Just look. Feel my presence. If you want to cry, please cry. And you know that I will cry with you. Tears you shed will heal both of us. Your tears are mine. The earth I tread this morning transcends history. Spring and winter are both present in this moment. The young leaf and the dead leaf are really one. My feet touch deathlessness, and my feet are yours. Walk with me now. Let us enter the dimension of oneness and see the cherry tree blossom in winter. Why should we talk about death? I don't need to die to be back with you. It is my great honor and my great pleasure to have loved a wonderful man. And I think I can say without a shadow of a doubt that he loved every one of us. And for that, we are better human beings. I would challenge us to keep that light with us and to spread it. It is my honor to host the memory of Benjamin J. McFall. I love you, Benny. We miss you. And we will see you soon. So another round of thanks to all of our participants. I am so deeply grateful for the time and the contributions. On behalf of the family and myself, today is a day that we'll remember forever. And with that, that's a wrap. Thank you for your time, guys.